This is Jake with Tattoo Improvement Network, and you are watching Fireside Technique. A couple of weeks ago, maybe a month ago now, I put out an episode about black shading for color tattoos, as opposed to doing black and gray shading and fully rendering for a tattoo that's going to remain black and gray. And after that episode, I got a handful of requests to do an episode on filling solid color. So I'm going to do something like that, not specifically filling solid color, but getting good color blends, getting nice blends from one tone to another, and we'll talk about getting solid color in there at the same time. And then we'll also address a little bit of how to pack color straight over the top of that black shading that we did a couple of episodes ago. So I'm working in right here on into a tattoo that's probably 2 or 3 years old. There's the piece on his shoulder and chest are existing. The little piece of the skull that's popping out from his inner arm is from the first sitting on this tattoo. And we lined everything and we packed in our blacks. And now I'm starting to transition from some of those reds and oranges that are in the existing tattoo to the tones that we're going to lay into the new piece, or to the expansion on the piece. And right off the bat here, you can see that I've taken a little bit of different approach than you would in traditional tattooing. I started with a medium tone, kind of like a copper or a caramel, and I'm laying more of a brick red on top of it. So I'm working kind of medium, or I'm sorry, I'm working kind of medium to dark rather than working from dark to light. And you'll see that I'll do that a little bit throughout this tattoo. And I think that I get some of my better blends that way. Right now I'm packing in a really, really pale yellow, and you'll see that in a little while I'll introduce a little bit warmer or darker tone on top of it. I just feel like that sometimes it saturates a little better, or I get a smoother blend if I lay the medium or the light tone in first and then kind of almost glaze or pepper that darker tone into it. And hopefully you'll see what I'm talking about whenever I get there. I do like to use the biggest needle configuration possible for as long as I can whenever I'm filling color, and also whenever I'm doing black shading as well. If you're a painter at all, you may have noticed that a lot of times whenever you come back to a painting at the end after you've been noodling with a small round brush for a while, and you get your big brush back out and you come back and you try to like soften edges or make marks, a lot of times you end up knocking out a lot of the noise of the painting and making the marks more simple, and the painting looks more deliberate, looks more intentional. I think I get that same effect with tattooing. I have a tendency to work too much detail in, to kind of, I know that if I have a small configuration, I'll start noodling in there and building little textures and all those kinds of things way too early. Whereas if I use a bigger needle configuration, I'll address larger shapes in a more simple way, which is usually the better way to approach it. So right now I'm trying to get this yellow in here, and I'm, you know, using a pretty traditional method, just small circles. I'm really paying attention to the skin, and that's easy to do in these lighter tones as far as paying attention to skin trauma. You can see if it's becoming evenly irritated, whenever it starts to bleed, if it looks like it's seeping evenly through, like from all from the entire area that you've covered. If you've overworked something, a lot of times it shows up really, really quickly. And if you're paying attention to it, you have to learn to read the skin. Now, right here, I'm starting to kind of push the ink rather than use those little circles. And the reason being is that this is where I'm going to transition to another tone at the end. So I'm packing in small circles the color that I want more solid. And as I get to an area that I don't care that it's as solid, because I'm going to layer on top of it, I'll start to kind of almost like push the machine like I'm trying to pepper out a traditional black and gray tattoo. See, I'm still using this 27 mag here, and I'm using it in a tiny little area. It's amazing really how much you can get done with a large needle configuration. You can get in little areas and kind of turn it up on its side. Here's an example of kind of working that darker tone back in. That yellow is in there. I was careful not to overwork it, and I went back with a little bit of a medium kind of copper tone that's in that upper area, and just kind of layered it in there, just kind of glazed it right on top. And it takes just a very simple little pass to make that happen, maybe a pass or two. Most important thing is that you're paying attention to the skin. If it looks like it's getting overworked at all, leave it. Don't try to do that. Let it heal and then come back and do it. Now I'm going into the darker area, and I'm laying a medium green right on top of my healed blacks. And what we'll get from that is just kind of a deep, dark green kind of fading into a lighter green. Guy Acheson mentioned something once when I was listening to him talk about how to think of packing color on top of color. And a lot of times we tend to think that we're going to cover a color with a color, even when we're doing like cover-ups, let's say. Like, I'm going to pack this color and it's going to cover up this color. It's not like you set a color on top of another color. Those colors live together inside the skin. I mean, those little particles of ink are sitting right next to each other in the skin. So when you're laying a color on a color, think of blending those colors instead of like packing over the color, if that makes any sense. And when I think of it that way, it helps me to kind of to visualize how these things are blending together. I'm thinking of small particles of ink kind of like flowing into another group of particles. So when you're laying color over black, you might mute the black a little bit. You can definitely tint it in one way or another, like I am right here in the skull. I'm using kind of an eggplant color directly over the black. And you can tint it one way or another, but the black is still living in the skin. It's sitting right there with that eggplant color. And so if you think of it that way, then you're more likely to be aware of it when you're laying the black in on the front end. And then how you blend that, like, for example, how I blend this eggplant color out of the black. I want to blend it the same way that I blended the black, so that when I move into the lighter tone, I have the same effect. So that one blend goes into another blend, goes into another blend, and that they can be as seamless as possible. Now, right here, you can see that I'm kind of shoveling again, kind of pushing the ink instead of scumbling in little circles. And that's because I'm getting to the area where I'm going to blend it into the next tone down. I'm going to start pulling my next color right on top of this eggplant color right here. Trying to be sure to wipe regularly and paying attention to the skin. I want to make sure that it's evenly worked. I don't have any little areas of texture or anything that looks crazy, or like it's getting beat up, or like it's bleeding profusely, anything like that. I'm trying to get the best saturation that I can with the least amount of skin trauma. And if you learn to read skin, you can do that every time. Now I've moved into kind of a slate blue that's a few values lighter than that eggplant. And I'm careful as I'm building this into that darker tone. I'm working slowly, deliberately, and I'm pushing small circles. This is where I want the greatest saturation, that transition point from the darker tone to the lighter tone. When I pull my light tone back into that dark tone, I want to make sure that I'm getting a really nice saturation right there. A lot of times you'll see like a bright area and a dark area, and then in the transition area, it looks kind of murky and muddy and almost like gray, like it didn't make, like the two didn't go together, and that's the reason. A lot of times people will either overwork that area or they won't work it enough, and you'll end up with kind of this murky transition that isn't fully saturated and doesn't look very rich. So I'm always paying attention whenever I'm putting my light tone up against my dark tone to overlap those two a little bit and get the best saturation that I can with the least amount of trauma. Another thing that I'm thinking of right now is my light source. So I've got my darks in there pretty well, and I'm pulling these slate blues down on top of it, but my light is actually coming from inside of the skull, my brightest light. So I'm trying to keep that in mind. It's gonna be kind of a nuclear green, kind of greenish yellow light coming from it. So I'm trying to think constantly of how far do I wanna push this slate blue. Where does the green kind of exit, that lime green kind of exit the light socket and illuminate the bone? So I'm always thinking of my light source and how those transitions would actually take place on those shapes. Here I am packing that eggplant right over the top of my black again. You can see how it tints it right there. It just gets a little more purple, and it'll make it look a little richer. You know, when you get that color in there, it'll look a little richer when it heals, as opposed to if you had just left the black in there. it would look a little bit flat and a little bit out of place. All right, now I'm introducing that green. And you'll notice I work an area and I kind of get away from it. Whenever I notice that it's getting to a point that I can't read the skin that well, I'll get out of there, I'll move to something else. I try to be sure that I continue to wipe it. I don't want to let any blood kind of bead up and sit there. So each time I'm wiping the area that I'm working on, I'm looking back to previously finished areas and making sure that I'm wiping those down and just paying attention to the skin in all of those areas. I'm always trying to decide if I can go back into it, if I can build another layer into it, if I can blend a little smoother. And if it gets to the point where I feel like I'm pushing my luck, then I won't. I'll let it be. And I'll deal with it in the next sitting, you know. And even if you're doing a one sitting tattoo, it's always better just to schedule a time to look through it and bump through stuff then, rather than to take the chance of overworking skin. So I'm using a little more of a yellowy green there. To me, greens, when I first started tattooing, they were the most difficult color for me to get in there really fully saturated. I don't know exactly why. I feel like there's a lot of white mixed into them, and they looked kind of splotchy. But really, you want to make sure that you're trusting yourself. I'm trying to read skin irritation, and I'm trying to kind of feel the ink go in the skin, if that makes any sense. And even if it looks splotchy, I know that it's in there. Or at the very least, I trust myself enough to leave it alone and look at it later, rather than just to continue to pound over it. I used to just pound over it and try to get greens looking fully saturated, and then they always just look more and more beat up, and then they never healed well, and it took me way too long to learn just to get them in there as best you can and leave them alone, and usually they're pretty solid. Notice whenever I moved to the back side of this leaf here that I changed the temperature of green. I went to more of like a seafoamy kind of, I think this is called melon. It's not as yellow, it's more of like it's mixed down with more white. A lot of times I see people that are filling an object and they're using the same color and they're just adding white or black to make it lighter or darker. Play around with using different versions of that color. You know, use a yellowy green on one side of it and then maybe a seafoamy green on the other side of this leaf and see. Always paying attention to your light source, and if you have a warmer light, then you're going to use the warmer green. And then when you get away from the light source, move to your cooler green. Make sure that you're, that there's a method to your madness. But I do think it's important to try to get away from using the exact same local color through the entire object, whatever it is. All right, here's the most tricky area to fill solid to me. Right here in the bend of the arm is very easily overworked. There's a lot of little blood vessels that are really easy to burst, and they'll turn all purple on you, and they'll start bleeding all weird, and they'll swell. So for this, I'm really slowing my hand down, and I'm paying attention in my off hand. I hope this makes sense. I'm paying attention to the vibration in my off hand, where I have my ring finger kind of placed down right there where I'm stretching. I'm feeling for the vibration in the skin, and if you pay attention to that, you can tell that you're getting a good saturation before you even wipe. It just feels like it's going in there solidly. Try to see if you can notice that feeling at all. I don't know if I've just invented that, but it makes sense to me, and I feel like that if I feel the vibration in my offhand and learn to recognize what that vibration feels like whenever the ink is going in solidly, then I'll recognize it, you know, all the time. You can see as I move down here, you can see if you look back up into the bend of the arm there, how it is kind of busted and swollen and looking crazy. That was just a single pass. So I left that thing pretty flat, pretty plain. I'm going to let it heal, and then I'm going to come back and noodle into it and build a few textures here and there. But I would rather just get a base layer in and try not to cause too much trauma. Can't see it anymore. It kind of zoomed out of the way, but it was definitely looking a little swollen, a little beat up up in the bend of the arm. All right, and the reason I included this, it has nothing to do with filling solid color, but don't be afraid to pull your liner out at the end of your sessions. and build your textures, whether you're, you know, doing color line work or something like this, or whether it's just a matter of getting that liner back out and making sure that your fills are going all the way up to your lines. A lot of times, you know, people get in a rush and they pull and they zip through, and you'll look at the work when it's healed and you can see these little bits of skin that are between the line and between the fill. And you might think that no one notices that, but your eye picks that up, and it's better just to take the time to let everything kind of sit for a minute, look back through it with your liner, pick out a few lines here or there, make sure that your fills are bumping all the way up to your lines. So I'm blending these things out, and here you go. Here's kind of a close-up of the tattoo, the part that I worked on today. And you can see it looks like it has pretty good saturation. Some of those greens are still a little bit irritated, so they look a little they look a little inconsistent, but once they heal down, they should be fine. And here it is with the original tattoo up on the shoulder, and you can see why I chose to stick with these lemony colors and these greens and these cool tones at the bottom to help offset all those reds that were at the top. That's it. Hope you guys liked it. Sign up for our mailing list at tattooimprovement.com. Keep up with what we're doing, and don't forget to leave a comment. You're awesome.